Well, I just want to say welcome to the church gathered at Forest Baptist. And as we have gathered this evening to partake of the lecture series we've been doing this month for Black History, again, I'd like to say thank you and welcome to you in your coming. This series, we have entitled it the Eliza Tibbetts Lecture Series in honor of the very woman who this church was founded in her living room. In 1867, Forest Baptist Church was founded in the living room of Eliza Tibbetts, a former slave who had received property from her former slave master. Last week we went a little bit more in depth into the history, but we are literally named Forest Baptist Church because former slaves gathered in the forest on stumps to worship the Lord. So it is a privilege and honor to be able to host this series and have some intellectuals come by and just to teach us some things, give us some insight and clarity. I really believe on using the calendar as we have it as an opportunity to take advantage of things. So being that it is Black History Month, Zuna, as a predominantly historical African-American church, use this month as an opportunity just to educate ourselves about some Black history. Our speaker for this day is none other than Reverend Dr. Curtis Woods. And he is very familiar to us at Forest Baptist Church, but I just want to read his bio so you would have that information. Brother Curtis is a graduate of the University of Arkansas at Pine Bluff, majoring in social work. He holds a Master in Theology and Pastoral Ministries from Dallas Theological Seminary, receiving the Reuben S. Conner Award in Evangelism and Discipleship. Curtis is a PhD candidate in Biblical Spirituality with emphasis in Early American Church History at the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary in Louisville, Kentucky. Curtis's research explains the dynamics of African diasporic evangelical thought on social activism. Curtis is a proud member of the African American Intellectual History National African American Fellowship of Southern Baptist Convention, Black Southern Baptist Denominational Leaders Network, and the Evangelical Theological Society. Curtis currently serves as the Associate Executive Director for Convention Relations for the KBC. And prior to this assignment, Curtis served as a social worker, assistant pastor, evangelism pastor, Baptist campus missionary, and church planter. Curtis is a lifelong learner, lover of the triune God and his beautiful creation. He is married to Sister Tracy Woods of North Little Rock, Arkansas. They have three sons and reside in Louisville, Kentucky. Tracy and the boys are his best friends. Amen to that and to his faithfulness. I've been able to witness that firsthand, his love for Jesus Christ, his love for the church, his love for his bride and family. So this evening, without further ado, we will have Brother Curtis Woods come and speak to us about Phillis Wheatley, Afrosensitive Spirituality in Colonial New England. But let me pray for us, and after that, Brother Curtis Woods will come. For your great and mighty love that you have for us, thank you for the blessing of the day. May we never take for granted any day that you give us breath. For Lord, when you give us breath, that means you have work for us to do. So Father, help us to be faithful to you, to your church, to your mission and purpose and creation that is to make disciples wherever you may go. And Father, your disciple, Brother Curtis, Lord, thank you for him. Thank you for what you have been doing in his life. Thank you for the academic training he has been receiving and creating. So Lord, I ask that you would use him to speak, to give us a perspective and insight on this woman, Lord, that you rescued so many years ago, dear God. For this time, in Jesus' name, we pray.
Hey, my name is Curtis Woods, and I do have the great joy and privilege of serving as the Associate Executive Director for Convention Relations for the Kentucky Baptist Convention. That simply means that I have the honor of, green light. Can y'all hear me? You want to give me a little bit more? Well, that simply means that I have the honor of going to 2,400 respective churches in the Kentucky Baptist Convention in order to preach the gospel, as well as to talk about issues that influence the way that we think about biblical Christianity. And that influencing, I would say, is that all of us understand that
that we have an experience. And we have an experience that our families of origin have placed in us, so that when we begin to think about God, when we begin to think about others, beauty and humanity, and the way that ideas have been developed throughout human history, all of that is informed first by what happens around our table in our homes. And I'm a full believer, I'm a firm believer, that when I begin to speak about these topics, the greatest place of discussion concerning the topic of history will always be in my kitchen, at my table, with my wife and my kids. Because I know that at that point, they're going to learn what it means to believe on the gospel of Jesus Christ and to allow the gospel of Jesus Christ to influence the way they interpret ideas, any idea. And so even as tonight we're discussing the life and the legacy of an enslaved African American woman by the name of Phillis Wheatley, who lived in the late 18th century from 1753 to 1784, I want you to understand that Phillis Wheatley's journey is about redemption. Her journey is about redemption. And so we'll look at a particular poem. We won't try to go through the breadth of Wheatley's poetry and her prose, but we'll look at one particular poem as I discuss what it means to apply Afrosensitive spirituality to the writings and to the works of Phillis Wheatley, as well as many other 18th century African-American evangelicals, okay? So that is our goal this evening. We want to find out more about what does it mean to understand and to read not only Wheatley's poetry, but to read 18th century African diasporic evangelicals' writing. That's what we want to discuss. How do we begin to read 18th century African diasporic evangelicals' writing? Now, I do have several friends who are here, and I won't attempt to name them all, but I definitely have to name the ones who I've had the joy and the privilege of doing life together with in Israel. Now, you know who you are, amen, but they are students and as well as faculty from the Augustan Honors Collegium, amen. Now, I like that, the Augustan Honors Collegium, because that's at Boyce College, and Boyce College is the college at Southern Seminary, the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. Their program director is Dr. Jonathan Arnold. Jonathan and I graduated from Dallas Theological Seminary together in 2005. The Lord has providentially led us back up here in Kentucky so that we can do life together as friends, connecting with one another in multiple ways. But I'm acknowledging them because of the concept of a collegium. Let me tell you what a collegium is by definition. A collegium is a group in which each member has approximately equal power and authority. That's it. That's a collegium. Each member in the group, that means the person who is speaking at that moment, whether it be if it's a professor or one of the students, they all have approximately equal power and authority. So in a collegium, the desire is to realize that it's not simply about observing the sage on the stage. It's about being in dialogue, because every individual brings a level or a body of knowledge to a conversation, right? So you bring an experience, you bring a body of knowledge to the conversation. So I am talking with you, I'm not talking at you or down to you. I'm in a conversation as best as I can to have a conversation about Phillis Wheatley, because I do not know what anyone in this room already knows about Phillis Wheatley. And the danger is assuming ignorance whenever you meet anyone, okay? And so that's what I'm not going to do. I'm not going to assume ignorance in this room. I'm actually going to assume knowledge, that you have a knowledge of history, that you have a knowledge of American history, and that you have a knowledge of how Africans, enslaved Africans, were treated from 1619 to 1865 in the American democratic experiment. I'm going to assume these things. It might be formal knowledge or it might be informal knowledge, but nonetheless, there is knowledge. Does that make sense? And so what I want to do is, I sort of want to define my term before we get started, because a win for us would be for us to be able to understand what I mean first when I say diaspora, right? What do I mean when I use the term evangelical, and what is the definition of Afrosensitivity? These are the things that we want to know. What do I mean as we think about Phillis Wheatley when I say diaspora? What does the term evangelical mean? And what does the idea or the concept of Afrosensitivity mean as we think and about Phillis Wheatley and some of her poetry? Okay? So the first thing is, what is diaspora? Because we said African diasporic history. Well, the word diaspora simply means dispersion. It's the same term that's used in the book of James when we look at how the church was dispersed. They were scattered abroad, right? So the diaspora, as it relates to African intellectual history or thought, means the forced dispersion of Africans worldwide through transatlantic slavery. That's the diaspora. So whenever you begin to study African intellectual history, you are either studying continental African intellectual history, that is to say, what occurred on the continent of Africa and what continues to occur, or you're studying diasporic African intellectual history. All right? So that's saying how individuals who were black, and when we think ethnicity, were treated in the colonial Americas, how they were treated in the colonies, how they were treated in Brazil, and how they were treated even outside of the colonies and Brazil. And so this is what we mean when we say diaspora. Diaspora is the forced dispersion of African peoples worldwide or globally through the transatlantic slave trade. If you want to hear or learn more about the African diaspora, I commend you to read or to peruse, because it's an encyclopedia about this thing, but it's called African Encarta, and it was edited by Henry Louis Gates Jr., who's a professor at Harvard University, and Kwame Appiah, who's also a professor at Harvard University, unless he just left and went to Princeton. I heard he might be trying to get another job. Amen. But the reality is that when we talk about the dispersion, we're saying, how do I begin to read African peoples based upon, here's the key word, agency? Are y'all with me now? How do I read African peoples based upon agency? In other words, could I be reading this individual, reading an idea that is Eurocentric into the ways in which this African person is writing their thoughts? Could that be the case? If I've been influenced primarily by Eurocentric thought, what do I mean Eurocentric thought? We can look at the term, let's look at the term neoclassicism, since people say that Phillis Wheatley, as we'll discuss, Wheatley was a neoclassicist. The word neoclassicism simply means neos, new, all right? Classic, and then think classical or the classics. We're talking about works that were written primarily in what, Greece or Rome. So studying the classic meant that you went to the shores of Greece in order to understand knowledge and to be thought of as intellectual. So if I can talk to you from that framework, then that framework in and of itself could be considered by many as a Eurocentric framework. So neoclassicism then is simply was a way within the 18th century where persons like Dryden, a poet by the name of Dryden and Dryden, and Alexander Pope utilized poetry in order to influence through satire and through logic and through reason how to influence their readers to make a change. So I actually like Alexander Pope, is what I'm trying to say. I actually like him. And I think Phillis Wheatley liked him because she employed much of his writing style, all right? Using what are known as heroic couplets. She does that in her writings. So what I'm trying to do then is I'm not necessarily trying to say that anything that is Eurocentric is wrong. That would be dangerous. And I'm not trying to say that anything that Afrocentric is right or wrong. That would be dangerous as well. But what I'm trying to say is that Afrocentrism, see, we got Eurocentric, we started there. Afrocentrism came into existence in order to say, I don't have to start my understanding of knowledge on the shores of Greece. I can start on the banks of the Nile. Are y'all with me? And so individual scholars like Malefi Kita Asante, who was at Temple University, actually began to design a principle called Afrocentrism. If you want to learn more about Afrocentrism, you can read Asante's works, or you can simply Google Malefi Kita Asante, and you'll see most of his published work as well as his website. And you can see what he means as it relates to agency, all right? But Afrocentrism basically says that it's going to challenge the way in which ideas have been propagated or given out or dispersed, right? And he's going to begin to challenge these things by saying, if I am reading a book, I must look at the language, the attitude, and the direction of that book to see whether or not the language, the attitude, and the direction of that book actually celebrate African identity formation. Are y'all with me? So Afrocentrism says, if there's not a celebration or a respect for African identity formation, then it's something I don't even need. I won't even read. Okay? So let's go back. We said neoclassicism, and we defined the classics as beginning in Europe and in Greece. Let's go back and ask ourselves, what makes those classical? And that's a question we ought to ask. I mean, who was the first person to say, you know what, here are the classics. Let's start with Greek and Roman. You ever ask yourself that question? Because these are the types of questions that persons like Malefi Kita Asante began to ask. And he began to research Africa and to put out literature about Africa. Sheikh Anta Diop did the same thing. Last name spelled D-I-O-P. So if you see Diop, it's Diop, okay? And he did the same thing. Chancellor Williams did the same thing in the destruction of Black civilization. These individuals started writing these works to say, we're not going to start with Greece and Rome. We're going to start on the banks of the Nile. We're going to tell a different story. Because history is actually storytelling, is it not? And it's funny because actually all of us today are doing history. And history involves a conversation between the past and the present because we are in the 21st century in dialogue with a woman who lived in the past in the 18th century. And we want her voice to speak rightly to our voices today. So we're doing history. It is a dialogue between the past and the present. And the goal is that the individuals in the present do their due diligence through evidence and through sound reasoning to say exactly what this person in the past would have said about themselves. We looked at what diaspora means, forced dispersion of African peoples worldwide through transatlantic slavery, right? We looked at Afrosensitivity. You have Eurocentrism, you have Afrocentrism, but Afrosensitivity is this. It is the synthesis between Eurocentrism and Afrocentrism insofar as Afrosensitivity says that when I read the works of Black people, I need to be quiet and listen well. Does that make sense? In other words, when I begin to read Wheatley, I better assume that Wheatley might be doing something more than just saying, I'm so happy that they kidnapped me from my parents and put me on the bows of a slave ship for 6 months. And I was emaciated and in rat-infested environment, and I was sold to strangers who I did not know for almost next to nothing because I was considered a refugee slave. Thank God for his providence. Hallelujah. It'd be better to go through that than to be in Africa. Y'all, doesn't that sound so great? That's a poem we're going to examine before we leave this place. And what I'm saying is that Afrosensitivity says, there may be something more to this. So let's examine the evidence to see whether or not this is true, or this claim is true, right? So that's we'll look at one poem that's popularized among evangelicals to support Wheatley's desire to highlight God's providence without critiquing the individuals who actually kidnapped her from West Africa. Okay, we'll look at that poem. So I use the term evangelicals again. So what is an evangelical, right? Because we use that term. I need you to understand that the evangelical does not necessarily represent the 81% of the persons who voted for Donald Trump during the last election cycle. Yeah, can I get an amen about that? That's not, y'all scared? I said Donald Trump, y'all get scared of me. No, I don't think so. I think it's a little bit more than that. So this is one of the reasons why I am unafraid at this juncture to jettison or to do away with the name evangelical. Because for me, evangelical is based upon theological identity, not its dominant constituency, okay? So then what do you mean, Curtis? Well, I actually gotta go to Britain to better understand this. Dare I say I went to Britain. Y'all taking my black heart, don't they? Because to better understand what I mean by evangelical, I'm actually going to read a brother by the name of David Bevington, Baptist historian. David Bevington writes a work where he gives us a terse or a clear definition for evangelical. Here's what he says. He says that the ingredients, that the rubrics for being an evangelical are this. If you are an evangelical, typically, he says, evangelicals have, number one, first, they believe in what's called biblicism. They have a high view of Scripture. That evangelicals believe that the Bible is the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation. In other words, when we read the Bible, we do not interrogate the Bible. We don't stand over the Bible. And we don't even stand alongside the Bible. Nor do we stand on the Bible, or on the Word, as we oftentimes say, right? No, we stand under the Bible. And in standing under the Bible, that means that the Bible becomes the rule and the guide to our faith and practice. Are y'all with me? We're going to get to Wheatley, but I can tell y'all what my whole principle is. Right? So then an evangelical starts with biblicism, 66 books of the Bible, absolutely trustworthy. So we believe in the authority of Scripture, the supremacy of Scripture, the simplicity of Scripture, right? And the sufficiency of Scripture. So that when I read Scripture, Scripture is going to tell me the truth, even if other people are telling me a lie about Scripture. I'm kidding, the Wheatley in a second. So I'm trying not to preach, but it's sort of like, if I preach here, I'm okay. But the beauty of it is, so evangelicals start with biblicism, but from biblicism, they don't stop it. They also know conversionism. What does it mean? You must be born again. In fact, one could almost put conversionism even above biblicism in the sense that we can't understand the word unless we've been born again. I oftentimes liken it to the old Charlie Brown movies. Anybody watch Charlie Brown? You remember how the parents sounded and the adults sounded in Charlie Brown? Well, that's how it was when individuals who do not have the Spirit try to read the Word of God. It's like the adults on Charlie Brown, they're spiritually appraised and discerned, they can't understand. So we believe in conversion. Evangelicals believe in conversionism, biblicism, but they also believe in crucicentrism. And I'm gonna have my son spell that because he just looked up at me. C-R-U-C-I-C-E-N-T-R-I-C-I-S-M, crucicentrism. All right? All it means is cross-centeredness. That we believe in the atonement of Jesus Christ. That our salvation rests on the person and work of Jesus Christ. There's only one mediator between God and man, and that is the man Christ Jesus. There's only one name under heaven why the men must be saved, and that is the name of Christ Jesus, right? So, crucicentrism. But don't stop there. Because there's one more aspect that leads us into thinking about Phillis Wheatley and her prose and her poetry. And it is this: activism. 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 Oftentimes people say, well, evangelicals were on the wrong side of the civil rights track. Have you ever heard comments like that, that evangelicals were uninvolved with social justice? Have you ever heard that before? I always respond this way: that's because you define evangelicalism based upon its constituents' parts and not upon the theological identity, because every black evangelical from the 18th century believed in activism. You won't find one who didn't. They had no option. Make sense? So some people say, like my friend Luke Harlow, as we discussed my thesis for about 8 hours, he said, Curtis, why use evangelical? Why not just say Protestant? I said, because I like evangelical. And I do. When it is theologically pure, in other words, when it fits that particular rubric, activism. Because we can't simply have conversations about ideas and think that we have done evangelical theology. See, a win for this, you'll see at the end, you'll see what my big win is as we conclude this conversation together. So the question is, who is Phillis Wheatley? We saw diaspora. We know what the diaspora is. Of course, dispersion of African peoples worldwide through the transatlantic slave trade. We saw that. We understand what Afrosensitivity is, and it is the synthesis between Eurocentrism and Afrocentrism, the synthesis. If we have a thesis here, an antithesis here, and then the synthesis for me is Afrosensitivity, right? And so we also saw what evangelical means. Evangelical means that we believe in the Word of God, we believe in conversion, we believe in cross-centeredness or Christ-centeredness, and we also believe in activism. So when we read Phillis Wheatley, I am reading Phillis Wheatley from that standpoint, okay? So who is Phillis Wheatley? Well, who was Phillis Wheatley, rather? Phillis Wheatley birthed the Afro-American literary tradition. Each African diasporic evangelical succeeding Wheatley personified much of her dissonance when they confronted societal maladies. Wheatley, however, was unique insofar as she employed a distinctly Augustinian, St. Augustine, 5th century church father, worldview, an Augustinian worldview coupled with a revised evangelical understanding of salvation. What do I mean by that? Wheatley affirmed God's sovereignty over good and evil, humankind's need for redemption through the person and work of Jesus Christ, and evangelical activism as a means of grace, liberating both soul and body. That's the key. She saw it as evangelical activism as a means of grace that should liberate not only the soul, but it should also liberate the body. Few evangelical scholars give serious attention to Wheatley's socio-political realities, which inform her theological and ethical preoccupations as an enslaved African woman living in 18th century colonial New England. John C. Shields, a non-evangelical Wheatley scholar, intimates that Wheatley's narrative was co-opted by thinkers with competing agendas. According to Shields, some presented Wheatley as the paragon of incipient feminism, while others positioned Wheatley on an overly religious plane. This is how Shields would critique me. Shields would say, your problem is that you actually believe that Wheatley believed the things that she wrote about Jesus. She didn't. She simply used it in order to survive in a racist society. That's what Shields would say. And I'd say to Shields, no, I don't think so, because when she was on her deathbed, she didn't give it up. Right? Now, if she started to give it up when she was about to die or when she could not receive support after she was emancipated in order to try to publish other works and she could not receive support, then I would have said maybe she simply used Christianity as a way towards emancipation. then I would say that. But no, she dies still believing. See, Shields more disparages both readers because he feels such construals say more about the commitment of the interpreter than it does the life and thought of Phillis Wheatley. Russell Reason believes Wheatley's work was devalued on aesthetic grounds and rejected on political grounds in the late 1960s by African American literary scholars who pictured Wheatley as, and I quote, an early female example of Uncle Tomism and accommodationism. Y'all, can I translate that for y'all over here? Here's what they believe. They believe these African American scholars in the late 1960s said about the mother of African American literature, she wasn't nothing but an old Uncle Tom sellout who said that slavery was good. Why should we even read this one? That's what many said. And she accommodated herself, believing that she was less than as a black person. That's what they said about me. No need to even read her books. So they allowed Afrocentrism to cause them to miss a daughter of Africa and to honor her in the right way. So one of my desires, and others have done it, but specifically one of my desires is to say, get your hands off my sister. Really, I mean, she's my mentor, right? You thought about my mentor? Let me show you, I had the privilege of being in Boston, Massachusetts, as we were heading to Israel. And so Jonathan told us, hey, we got some time between the flight. I was like, good, I'm out. And so I went down into Boston and I saw her statue because she, you know, of course from West Africa, Senegambia, but she was taken to Boston, Massachusetts in 1761. And so they were honoring this daughter, literary genius in bondage, with this statue here. And I had a picture, I had a chance to take that with my voice gear on, y'all. And I keep that picture to remind me of my mentor, Phillis Wheatley, because she is my mentor. She speaks into my consciousness. She showed me how to better understand racial hierarchialism, not only in the 18th century, but racial hierarchialism in the 21st century. Another way of saying racial hierarchialism is to say white supremacy. And what does white supremacy mean? Is it simply situational, or is it systemic, or is it both? The answer is it is both individual and institutional. It is both. White supremacy is when an individual comes to the conclusion that if anything is right, it must be white, and you have to interpret everything else through that lens. Are y'all with me? That's why there's such a thing as intellectual racism. And you don't create a conversation with you don't create conversations with multiple ethnicities in order to understand an idea. So I have to read Native Americans if I want to better understand colonial America. Hence the reason why the late Richard Twist would say this statement. He says, I'm so frustrated. He was a Native American theologian, PhD from Asbury Theological Seminary, created NAITS, which is a Native American Institution for Theological Studies. Watch this. Richard Twist said in a conference once, he says, I'm so sick of hearing individuals talk about having stronger borders. He said, doggone it, we should have had stronger borders. Some of y'all can catch that on the way home. He's Native American, amen, pilgrims, y'all know. He said, we should have had stronger borders. What was the point? Now, Twist, through a Native American lens, as a first people, he is now saying that the way that we think about some of these ideas is skewed. Have a conversation with a Native American about some of these social values. Make sense? And there are works written by evangelicals, because Twist is an evangelical theologian, was an evangelical theologian, that challenges these ideas. And so my goal then, as we're talking about Phillis Wheatley, is that I maintain a distinctly theological reading of Wheatley, who I believe fashioned a new form of evangelical protest through an opaque lens of African identity formation. In other words, readers of Wheatley should avoid the conclusion that Wheatley's African mind was completely eradicated through the stripping process. What is the stripping process? The stripping process was the warehousing and the transportation of enslaved Africans. But they were warehoused for a purpose. What was that purpose? Some believe to totally annihilate their understanding of their previous lives so that they could become docile through the transportation process. And then in that docility, you now have a slave. So there's much debate on that issue, right? I'm saying to you, I see too many Africanisms in Wheatley as well as in the Black church experience that prove to me that that was not totally eradicated. African identity was not totally eradicated. Are y'all with me on this? Or at least what I'm trying to argue. So Wheatley adopted and later adapted evangelical theology as an instrument of remonstration, exposing political and sociological tyranny executed against African peoples in early America. Wheatley was kidnapped at the tender age of 6 or 7 from her native land. 6 or 7. The next time you see a 6 or 7 year old child, to better understand Phillis Wheatley, take that 6 or 7 year old child, strip that child naked, take that child, place that child in chains, put that child in a warehouse, and then take that child from the warehouse and throw that child on a boat in chains, knowing that that boat is disease infected and it will take 6 months for that child to make it to its destination. Your hope is that that child might live. But the opportunity for wealth is more important than that child did, right? 6 or 7 years old, this is what we're talking about, the experience of Phillis Wheatley. She arrives famished and afraid on the shores of New England after a treacherous 6 month journey through the dreaded Middle Passage. Upon arrival, Wheatley and her caged cohorts entered a strange new world. In this world, abject poverty and forced labor characterized their perpetual existence as chattel. What is chattel? Charlotte Fett rightly articulates the chattel principle as a principle that defined human beings as movable property in perpetuity forever through the mother's line of descent. They had no right to life, liberty, or the pursuit of happiness. Bracket, economic autonomy. They could not create wealth for themselves. Are y'all with me on this? That's chattel slavery. European slavers considered their cargo black gold because of the lucrative slave market in colonial America. Slavers and buyers severed African families long before they reached the shame-inducing auction block. So there was supply and demand management, slavers and buyers. The buyers were also complicit, right? So when we talk about the individuals who purchased Phillis Wheatley, namely Jonathan and Susanna Wheatley, Jonathan Wheatley purchased Phillis Wheatley, purchased this enslaved child so that she could become a lifetime domestic slave for his wife, Susanna, and his 2 teenage twins, Mary and Nathaniel. See, some of these ravished bodies came with a hefty purse, especially if they were physically endowed. Others, like this small prepubescent child, were less valuable. According to Vincent Coretta, who writes a biography of Phillis Wheatley entitled The Biography of a Genius in Bondage, John and Susanna Wheatley purchased the African child as a refuge slave on 11 July 1761. As refuge, Wheatley brought little economic value to the seller because of her frailness. During the auction, Susanna Wheatley laid eyes on the destitute child, and perhaps seeing the child's troubled lot, made a bid despite the obvious economic disadvantage. You see the sensitivity perhaps in that? So we can't just automatically assume the worst. Perhaps she saw this destitute child and she said, you know what? Because I just lost a daughter who was 7 years old, and now I'm seeing this daughter who is 7 years old, and even though she's emaciated and she may not even survive the next month, go ahead, purchase her. That could be a part of it. But then the other side of that I always have to proffer is this, and when we purchase her, we'll free her and raise her as our own. That's the other side of it. Because I can't simply stop with, oh, New England, what's known as New England sentimentalism. Well, we'll purchase her as an enslaved child and raise her as our own. Well, you're not raising her as your own if she's not emancipated and has a right to your inheritance. Right? Economic. A wonderful scholar has a book entitled Disowning Slavery. And her name is Joanne Pope Mellis. She taught for several years at Brown University, retired at the University of Kentucky. She moved back up to New England just to be an independent scholar. But the title of that book is Disowning Slavery. She talks about and critiques New England sentimentalism in her work, Joanne Pope Mellis. See, some scholars assume Susanna was attracted to Wheatley because she reminded her of her daughter who had recently passed away. Wheatley, therefore, could become a viable replacement for the grieving mother. After taking ownership of this unfortunate victim of economic war, the Wheatleys redefined the child's African identity. First, they renamed the child Phillis. Because remember, her life begins in Africa, West Africa, Senegambia, which is perhaps the region between Senegal and Ghana. So you can say Senegal, Gambia, and Ghana. That particular region in West Africa is where Phillis Wheatley derived from. She was probably Fulani. And that is her identity. She is African. But now what they're going to do is they're going to rename Phillis. They're going to rip her of her identity. Right? What name do they give her? They name her after the slave ship that imprisoned her, Phillis. She arrived on the Phillis. So it's almost as if we can see this, purchase her. And what shall we name her? That's a beautiful name. Call her Phillis. And her last name is Wheatley. Not because she has a right to an inheritance, but because it shows ownership. See, this is how you begin to read 18th century African diasporic evangelicals. That type of sensitivity begins to put you at a posture of saying, when I read their words, there may be something else going on under the surface. So you begin to look for satire. You begin to look for subversion and subversive speech, and you begin to discover the ethical use of duplicity. Ethical use of duplicity. Because people say, no, duplicity is always unethical. Is it? Hebrew midwives, were they duplicitous? Absolutely. Y'all remember them, right? Kill the firstborn Israel male child. What did? They kill him? No. They hide him, though. And God says about these Hebrew midwives, they were people of faith, Hebrews chapter 11. They used duplicity. who is ethical. Any other examples you can think of an ethical use of duplicity? Right? Samuel and David, yeah. And McCall sort of helped out David too, didn't she? So you start reading 1 Samuel, right? Chapter 18, 19, and 20. That's a great example, right? We see other examples. Rahab, also known as Rahab the harlot, right? We saw duplicity in her statements. The Magi, they're supposed to go back and tell Herod what? I'm just making sure I ain't doing First Project 3 to 5, that's all. Evidence. And they're supposed to go back and tell Herod, hey, we found the king. But the Lord tells them to him, that's not, I'm going to go back because he has an unethical use of duplicity. I need you to go the other way. He don't need to know. All right? Am I right? So for me, I not only have biblical precedent, and there's more, we'll just look at those four, but I not only have biblical precedent, I also have precedent within human experience. The Underground Railroad would not have existed if duplicity is always evil. There would be no Underground Railroad. Because it was a system of duplicity in order to save and to protect life. Slavery, literal slavery, not figurative slavery, right there in their own backyards. And so when Wheatley would write in her poetry, she would write and honor George Washington, and she would critique King George in honor of George Washington. But then when she would write, as she published her poems that would eventually be published in London and not in America because she could not find a publisher in America because she was an enslaved African woman. So she had to go to London in order to be published. Right? So when Wheatley was writing, Wheatley would say one thing about King George, but then Wheatley would say another thing when she's trying to get published. Oh, God, we appreciate the king. He has the ability to free this African sable race. What does she mean? America's still under the British Empire's reign. Oh, you can do some work if you wanted to. So she would challenge them. She would challenge individual. She was brilliant. I don't know any other way to deal with it. And she had an ethical use of duplicity in her writing. We'll just look at one for a minute. What time is it, y'all? I'm gonna hold y'all to you. Good. I know y'all been in church all day. So let me skip a little bit. I'll skip a little bit here. Let's talk just really quickly about what I would consider complicit captors, Jonathan and Susanna Wheatley. And let's discover who the first biographer, Margaret Matilda Odell, writes the first biography of Phillis Wheatley in 1837. And she became the authorial sine qua non. That she was the irreducible member, all right? Sine qua non, for understanding the life and thought of Phillis Wheatley. Unfortunately, Odell's commitment to her forebears, John and Susanna Wheatley, skewed her biography. She never spoke harshly against the Wheatley, even though Phillis seems to question their unconditional, scare quotes, unconditional love in a poem that reflects on her African mother's love and spirituality. Odell was the great grandniece of Susanna Wheatley. So in Boston, on 11 July 1776, at 1761, when she was purchased, if we jump forward in Wheatley's religious experience, her parents, or her captors rather, were members of the New South Congregational Church. They were evangelical Christians, and Wheatley was baptized in 1771 in the Old South Church under Samuel Cooper, who, as we'll see, was the fifth signature attesting to the writings and the works of Phillis Wheatley. So Phillis was not even baptized into the New South Congregational Church. Some scholars say it's because of her ethnicity, because she was an enslaved child. Some scholars argue that. Others say, no, it's because Jonathan Wheatley had a relationship with Samuel Cooper, and Phillis Wheatley had a friendship with the Coopers. That's what some say. Phillis will let us know when we see her in heaven. Amen. But as we jump forward from these complicit captors, and they're complicit because of supply and demand management, let's look a little bit, let's discover how Phillis grew intellectually, all right? In this particular work, the collected works of Phillis Wheatley, I'll read to you the attestation that her master wrote in order for her poems to be published. So this is original, right? This is a copy of the original, right? So this is what was written by John Wheatley. He said, Phillis was brought from Africa to America in the year of 1761, between 7 and 8 years of age, without any assistance from school education, and by only what she was taught in the family. So she was homeschooled. She, in 16 months' time from her arrival, attained the English language to which she was an utter stranger before, to such a degree as to read any and the most difficult parts of the sacred writings, the Bible, to the great astonishment of all who heard her. As to her writing, her own curiosity led her to it, and this she learned in a short amount of time. Back in the year of 1765, she wrote a letter to the Reverend Mr. Ockham, Samson Ockham, the Indian minister while in England. She has a great inclination to learn the Latin tongue and has made some progress in it. This relation is given by her master who bought her and with whom she now lives, John Wheatley. So he writes this in order to say, the things that you are going to read from Phillis Wheatley are authentic because I am saying they are. Can y'all see something wrong with that? How does she gain credibility? She has to gain credibility in a patriarchal society dominated by wealthy white male landowners through the lens of a wealthy white male landowner. You see, that's where her credibility comes. But he's still just one. So then what he must do to the public, he says, let me get some more of my friends to give her credibility. Why does he want to give her credibility? Can we just dialogue real quick? Why does John Wheatley desire to give Wheatley credit, Phillis credibility? Why?
He wants credit.
It's lucrative. You said what? It's an investment. So he sees this young lady in 16 months show intellectual prowess, and he says, oh girl, we done hit the jackpot. Are y'all with me? So everything he does to develop Phillis Wheatley, with Mary coming alongside her and tutoring, Matthew Biles coming alongside her and tutoring, is because they see a financial investment. They see bank. This is why I question whether or not they were sincere in their love for Phillis. And I think she questioned it as well because of what she writes in certain poems about her African mother. She calls her mother and she says, I remember mom. But then when she writes about Susanna Wheatley, she uses a simile. She says she was somewhat like a mom. Y'all see? Subversion there. Somewhat like a mom to me. When you're reading African diasporic evangelicals in the 18th century sensitively, you say, watch out, something's going on with that statement. And you slow down and humble yourself and say, I wonder what it is. Okay? It happens all the time in the literature. I challenge you to purchase a work by Vincent Ferretti entitled Unchained Voices. And he's looking at 18th century African diaspora literature. And he uses about maybe 15 to 20 individuals that he engages in that work. So he gets, listen to these names, to give a testament to Phillis Wheatley's writings. Thomas Hutchison, governor. Andrew Oliver, lieutenant governor. The Honorable Thomas Hubbard. The Honorable John Irvin. The Honorable James Pitts. The Honorable Harrison Gray. The Honorable James Bowden. John Hancock, y'all heard that before? Joseph Green. Richard Carey. The Reverend Charles Chaney. The Reverend Mather Biles, the Reverend Ed Pemberton, the Reverend Andrew Elliott, the Reverend Samuel Cooper, that's a baptized. The Reverend Samuel Mather, that's some pretty good lineage there. The Reverend Mr. June Moorhead and Mr. John Wheatley, her master. Are y'all seeing what I'm trying to say? So when you critique patriarchalism in reading Wheatley, you just begin right there. In other words, she has to write subversively because she cannot simply say how she feels about white supremacy and patriarchalism. She can't. But she critiques it through a biblical lens, is what I'm trying to show you. And we have the responsibility, and we have the privilege, I think, of reading Wheatley from that framework and saying, Wheatley, show me what spirituality looks like. And Wheatley would say, spirituality is the spiritual disciplines, yes, that connect me with God, but they also connect me with those who created in the image of God. And Wheatley would say, I question your spirituality if you can say you're connected to God and keep me in chains. And she said that. First subversively until she's emancipated. And you read her prose and her letters, and she says that she takes her gloves off. And once she started taking her gloves off, here's what you need to hear, and I'll try to just close this thing out. Once she takes her gloves off, listen, no one has her back. When she starts to speak the truth, after her captors die, after John and Susanna Wheatley dies and Nathaniel Wheatley dies, she has no one to speak on her behalf, and now she's married to a black man by the name of John Peters, and she's even taken his name, Phillis Peters, and she's still brilliant, she's still writing, and she cannot get her next book of poems published in Boston. No one will touch her. No one will touch her. And Phillis Wheatley dies, and her three children die in abject poverty. And her husband at that time was likely incarcerated in debtor's prison. And don't think about debtor's prison like we think about perhaps someone who might go to prison for a criminal offense, right? There were a lot of individuals who experienced debtor's prison. Many of us, some of us, would be in debtor's prison right now if they looked at your credit card, right? So this man, John Peters, would look for work in different areas, and in order to get work, sometimes he would have to say, okay, I'll work for you, but I don't have any money right now. Would you be willing to what? To give me a banknote? Would you be willing to sponsor me even in this job? And then I'll work for you. And when your sponsorship is up, then I'll have the ability to create and make my own wealth. Sometimes he did that and people didn't pay him. So what would he have to do? Could he say, well, you're not going to pay me? No. This black man in 18th century New England, he had to find another work. And he just worked for free. And eventually they took that and they incarcerated him. I'm saying that because when you read the 1837 biography by Matilda Odell, she calls him a vagabond. I said, Matilda, you're not Afrosensitive. You're not reading this brother's life well. Because you're not considering what caused him to enter into a debtor's prison. And my good friend Michael A.G. Haken, when I was up at Princeton in August, asked me, he said, Curtis, have you read Honoree Fanon Jeffers' work, The Peas and Pledges, the Deeds, rather, and Pledges of Our Love, a defense of Phillis Wheatley's husband? I was like, no, brother, I haven't read it. He said, you need to. I think you'd enjoy it. And that particular essay was defending the very thesis that I had. And I was like, wow, yeah, I knew I wasn't alone on this one. Michael Haken is a church history and spirituality professor at Southern Seminary. So what I'm trying to show, and I know we've talked about a lot, but what I want to do in this picture, if you're up here, I want to show you really quickly what subversive speech looks like in this front piece, just to give you an example of a picture that Scipio Moorhead painted of Phillis Wheatley. This is a popular picture. You've probably seen it before. Is that this picture is a picture, it's a form of protest. So you have Phillis Wheatley, intellectual posture, you know, with her hand on her chin. She has her pen, her fountain pen in her hand. This perhaps the scriptures, the sacred writings, and she's thinking. But within the oval is what? The statement, Phillis Wheatley, Negro servant to Mr. John Wheatley of Boston. Some have argued that Scipio Moorhead and Phillis decided to do this to say that her identity and her ability to think well and to create work from her thoughts was encased. And they did it purposely to say that no, as you look at this particular arch here, that she's encased and she's framed. Her identity is based upon her enslavement, and she will have no opportunities in this life that John Wheatley does not afford for her. When you read her poem about Scipio Moorhead, I think it's true. I think that's what was happening. It was supposed to. And that's what all I want you to see is, I want you to see that as you approach Phillis Wheatley in particular, and other African diaspora intellectuals, evangelical intellectuals, 18th century, I want you to say to yourself, I might be reading them wrongly, I need to read them rightly. And that means I should submit to their voice, watch the language, the attitude, and the direction, in order to really experience what it meant to be an enslaved African in the midst of white supremacy. That's what Phillis does. Could you not find it?
No, I got a power fade.
Oh, did you? It's fine. So let me read this poem to you, and then we'll close out. Or if there's questions, we can have questions. This is one of the most popular poems of Phillis's work. And it's called On Being Brought from Africa to America. Anybody heard of that particular poem? Yeah. I'm going to read it to you, and I'll show you why I think there's subversive speech in this poem. It says, 'Twas mercy brought me from my pagan land, taught my benighted soul to understand that there's a God, that there's a Savior too. Once our redemption neither sought nor knew. Some view our sable race with scornful eye. Their color is a diabolic dye. Remember, Christians, Negroes black as cane may be refined and join the angelic train. When you read this and you do exegesis, if you will, over this, you'll see that she says, 'Twas mercy that brought me from my pagan land. The pagan is italicized. And oftentimes, in Wheatley's writing and other 18th century poetry, you would look at the grammatical and the syntactical constructs to see what they were doing to allude to satire or subversion. So she says, pagan land, and it is italicized. Why? Because she is not saying, I agree that the land is pagan, but this is what you say about the land. Then she goes on and says, taught my benighted soul to understand that there's a God, that there's a Savior, too. Savior is also italicized. And what she means by that is that you actually could have told me about the Savior in my land. Face with a scornful eye, their color is a diabolic dye. And then she does, here's what I think is her knockout punch. She says, remember, Christians, italicized. But she doesn't stop there. Now she's going, remember, comma, Christians, italics, comma, Negroes, italics, comma, black as Cain. Now what does she mean by black as Cain? Now she's going back to what? The false belief that the mark of Cain was a reference to blackness. And so she's critiquing that. She's saying, you got that wrong. Because the mark on Cain actually protected him. It didn't cause him harm. And then she goes on and says, may be refined and join the angelic train. What does she mean by may be refined and join the angelic train? She said there's equality in all people groups, especially black people. That angelic train, we're going to be on that train too.
Yeah.
That's just one example. There's a whole bunch of them in here.